Okay. Good evening and welcome everybody tonight to our Committee of the Whole meeting. To start off our Committee of the Whole meeting tonight, we have a public hearing. So tonight's public hearing is to consider amending the land use bylaw to rezone a portion of a property along Dennis Point Road, Lower West Pubnico, PID 900-81142 from marine industrial zone to a light industrial zone. So councillors, this evening, we have one item on the public hearing agenda scheduled to begin at 6:30. The purpose of this hearing is for council to hear input from the public prior to making a decision on the proposal. To the members of the public who have chosen to come this evening, welcome. Everyone that wishes will have an opportunity to be heard. For those joining us via Facebook Live, feel free to ask questions during staff's presentation. Tonight, council may approve, reject, or defer its decision on the proposal to a later date. Council approval is required for the process for the proposal to proceed. I will now ask the municipal clerk to outline when the public hearing advertisements were published.
Hi, Deputy Warden, Council. Public hearing notice appeared in the March 10th and March 17 editions of the Vanguard. The notice described the proposal, gave the date, time, and location of this public hearing, and indicated that the report outlining the proposed application was available to the public if requested. Staff also posted the notice of this hearing on the municipality's Facebook site. Posters were placed at six different local businesses informing residents of this hearing, and letters were also sent to residents, businesses, and landowners who are 152 meters from the development site.
Councillors, on the public hearing schedule this evening is a proposal to consider amending the land use bylaw to rezone a portion of a property along Dennis Point Road, Lower West Pubnico. As I previously mentioned, PID 900-81142 from marine industrial zone to light industrial zone. I would now ask Jared Dalziel, project manager from WSP, to present his report.
Thank you very much. Your Worship, did that go through with the screen share?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Okay, so the application for consideration this evening is for rezoning or a mapping amendment to the land use bylaw from the light industrial zone to enable a micro cannabis production processing facility. The proposed use, a cannabis production processing facility, is not permitted under the property's current marine industrial zone. The light industrial zone permits micro cannabis production and processing facilities as of right. This means that if approval is given to the application this evening and the proposed building or the proposed development meets requirements of the zoning bylaw for setbacks, lot area, and other requirements, just basically the general regulations, that a development permit could be issued for the proposal. As a rezoning application, council is obligated to base their decisions on the policies contained in the municipal planning strategy, and those relevant policies are outlined in the staff report attached to the agenda this evening. In terms of context, it's located in the marine industrial area in Lower West Pubnico, around where that white triangle is shown on the map. It's located on the Dennis Point Road, near the Dennis Point Wharf in Lower West Pubnico. It's currently a vacant property and it's undeveloped marine industrial land. The property size is just under 5 acres at 4.9 acres. The area to be rezoned, shown in teal on the map, is just over 3 acres with about 14 meters of frontage. Just for context, the Dennis Point Cafe is shown there as well. Proposed property is split zone with a portion of the zoning fronting the Dennis Point Road being zoned marine industrial or MI zone, and the rear portion being zoned mixed use zone. And this proposal is not to change the rear portion of the property, so the portion zoned mixed use. That would actually require a municipal planning strategy amendment and be a bit of a larger application. The map shown on the slide there, that black line shown is the dividing line in the zoning maps. Between the mixed-use zoning and the marine industrial zoning at the present time. In terms of the zoning around kind of the application site. Adjacent properties fronting under the Dennis Point Road are zoned marine industrial, with properties in the rear being zoned mixed use zone. Signage was posted on the property on February 1st, informing residents of the proposed land use bylaw amendment application, and the frontage is shown there just for everybody's reference. In terms of the application itself, the Cannabis Act permits up to a maximum of 200 square meters of cultivation area as part of one of these micro production facilities. While the Cannabis Act does restrict that area up to that maximum size, there could be multiple premises on a single property under our zoning bylaw. So you could have multiple 200 meter basically building areas divided with like firewalls and so on. Two options have been presented by the applicant for the proposed building to contain 12 bays, and bays being basically these reformatted shipping containers, either a one story height building of about around 120 feet by 60 feet, or alternately a double height building around 80 by 60 feet. So they'd be basically stacked on top of each other with essentially a catwalk that would let you kind of access both of the bays. The proposed production facility itself is proposed to be composed of self-contained grow pods. However, they're not held to that as part of this application. These federal licensing requirements take quite a period of time to kind of get through and get everything approved on. So really the question here tonight is for the zoning change itself. Just in terms of what some of these facilities look like on the inside, just for some examples, they're quite medical for the most part because of the sanitation requirements that the Federal Cannabis Act requires. Furthermore, any building used for cannabis production processing is required to have systems to filter air under the Federal Cannabis Act to prevent the escape of odors associated with cannabis to the outdoors. Just for reference, licenses under the Cannabis Act are valid for a maximum of 2 years and are not automatically renewed. So if an operator fails to comply with the regulations in place under that federal act, they run the risk of not having their license renewed, which is a large encouragement to comply with the regulations, both kind of throughout the act, as well as these dealing with kind of nuisance or odors. Our company has recently completed interviews with planning departments who approved cannabis production facilities in Nova Scotia and New Brunswick. For the properties or the groups we've interviewed in Nova Scotia, no land use conflicts were experienced during operation. So smells, traffic, things like that. There was some issues in New Brunswick, mainly dealing with like large facilities where the filtration system put in place at the beginning wasn't sufficient, or smaller operations that when they first came into being hadn't put similarly the same controls in place. Same with any type of new business. When these kind of first came online, there was additional issues, which people kind of started to understand as they've developed these facilities and we've got more experience with it. So if the amendment is approved, the subject property will be permitted to grow cannabis, process cannabis for wholesale trade as a licensed producer, and sell cannabis for medical purposes. So those authorized under the Healthcare Practitioners in Health Canada. Just for context, so this wouldn't change the commercial consumption or sale rules that are under the province. So still recreational cannabis can only be bought and sold at the NSLC in Nova Scotia. In terms of municipal planning strategy policy considerations, as I mentioned before, the detailed look at kind of the municipal planning strategy policies are in Appendix B of the staff report. Overall, just for context, existing policies in the municipal plan allow council to consider amendments to land use bylaw regulations, basically the zoning, without requiring amendments to the municipal planning strategy. So the policy designation areas, as both zones share what's called the rural center designation. So the general idea of that is there's these designated areas within the municipal plan that a number of zones could occupy. Both of the zones, so the current marine industrial zone or the proposed light industrial zone, both fall within that designation area. And furthermore, there's what's called an enabling policy. So basically a policy that lets council consider this type of application, which would be policy 13.11.2 with municipal plan. In terms of discussion, the surrounding properties along Dennis Point Road are currently split zoned marine industrial for the portion of the lots fronting onto the Dennis Point Road and mixed use zone at the rear. However, the size changes, so some of them are, some of them aren't. But as you saw previously, that's kind of where the dividing line is through a section of this property. The mixed use zone residential properties, they're located approximately 444 meters from the proposed portion of the property being rezoned to light industrial. So quite a distance away for those existing residences. Typically in like Ontario, for instance, a lot of the setback requirements vary between about 50 to 75 meters for micro cannabis production facilities. So we're far in excess of that with the proposal here tonight. The rural center designation recognizes that land uses near the wharf or wharf facilities are primarily for marine industrial uses. However, light industrial uses are also kind of permitted within these areas if they do not conflict with residential uses. Kind of just for the overall intent of kind of these plan areas, the intent of the marine industrial zone is to accommodate an ample supply of land for fishery and marine related industrial uses. However, as part of the kind of this analysis, there's a lot of undeveloped marine industrial land at the moment. So there's ample opportunity for those uses to expand in the future. And we don't feel like there's a risk of kind of shortening your supply of marine industrial land with this proposal tonight. Staff's reviewed the applications based on the policies contained in the municipal plan, and they found that them generally consistent, the application generally consistent with the spirit and intent of the municipal plan. In terms of public engagement, a public hearing is required for the land use bylaw amendments to hear input from the community, which is why we're here tonight. Staff have complied with the public participation policy of the municipal plan, as well as the direction from council at the first reading of the application. An advertisement outlining the proposal indicating it has been received and under review by staff was placed in the March 10th, 17th editions of the Tri-County Vanguard. And a notice of the application was also placed on the municipal website. And as the municipal clerk noted, a number of posters were also put up informing residents of the hearing. Further to that, a mail out was given to all property owners and businesses within 152 meters of the portion of the property proposed to be rezoned, which was about 13 letters that went out. In terms of next steps, staff have completed their review of the proposal. No written public feedback was received for the application. I would note that there is a right to appeal option for both approval and refusal of the amendments to the land use bylaw or the rezoning. So basically following the public hearing here tonight, council will likely make a decision at their subsequent meeting. And following either that approval or refusal, if it's a refusal, the applicant has the option to appeal that refusal based on if the decision was consistent with the policies of the municipal plan. Similarly, an aggrieved person can appeal the decision of council if it's an approval. And there's a 14-day appeal period for that after the notice of approval is published in a newspaper. So likely the entire process will likely be concluded in a month, assuming there's not a deferral of the decision of council. The recommendation is above, and that concludes my presentation.
Thank you. Next, do we have any members of council who have any questions for staff? Is there anybody that has anything they would like to ask? Any councillors? Seeing none, I'm going to move on. Are there any members of staff? Sorry, I will open up the floor for comments and questions. Any comments or questions from people in the public tonight? Just raise your hand if you would like to comment, question. No? So this is the opportunity for the public to ask questions. Okay. Are there any comments on Facebook, CAO News?
There are none.
Nothing on Facebook. Any members of staff have any final comments?
Nope.
Yes, Councillor Digdon.
Thank you. I believe we have B. Dontrema that's watching here this evening that had wanted, I was told he was going to make a presentation. Now I'm not sure what's going on or if he's having trouble with his Zoom connection or what's going on. But okay. I see he's in the gallery here.
Okay. Hi, how are you, Glenn?
Good. Mr. Dontrema, would you like to speak?
Yeah, we have technical difficulties here.
Okay.
We lost you for a bit there. I'm sorry about that.
No problem.
Number one, I'm not opposed to the project. The only thing I have a few concerns because I am alongside, I own the land, Acadian owned the land right next to the proposed land that's going to be used. And so that is why my concern, and I take great pride, and anybody that knows me knows that, and keeping the plant clean and no odor in the fish plant. And I would be, I'm concerned about the smell. I don't know enough about it to complain because I don't know the whole thing. But, and water, we have a well that we, three plants actually raining from that well now. And we feel that if they're going to have, they're going to need a lot of water, they would have to make their own well because this well cannot take care of everybody, according to Ray Dontamo, which is our local plumber. And basically, I wish the guys well. I hope this business does make a lot of money for them and stuff. So I'm not opposed to it. I just got a few concerns. Number one, the water. Where are they going to get that water? And the smell. So if those things, two things are taken care of, I'm perfectly fine.
Thank you. Is there somebody who would like to answer that? So his two concerns were around the water and the smell.
I'd like to, if possible.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Deputy Warden and Councillors, my name's Av Singh. I'm an independent cannabis consultant and a faculty member teaching the cannabis cultivation course at the Nova Scotia Community College. I just wanted to comment to Mr. Dontremont's concerns, and they're both incredibly valid. The aromas that come from the cannabis plant are medicinal, but they are can be offensive. Many people do not enjoy the aroma that comes from the cannabis plant. As Jared pointed out, it is the responsibility of the licensed producer to mitigate those odors. So the design of the facility should ensure that all air that is being exhausted out of the facility has all of the odor removed. That doesn't mean that it'll be perfectly scentless, because there is always some passive air that is leaving the building. The clothes on the members working in the facility will naturally have some of that odor, but that odor should be no greater than what you would have if you were roasting coffee or something like that. So it is incumbent on the licensed producer to ensure that their neighbors are not being offended by these odors, and neighbors can make a complaint to ensure that the licensed producer is kept in check. I potentially may do some consulting with the owners of these facilities, and we have technologies that we recommend beyond the typical charcoal filter, in which we incorporate a ozone creator that will take the terpenes are the chemicals that produce this odor, and dissolve them into their components, which are just carbon and hydrogen. So if they use this unit, which is called the core unit, you should have 99.9% of the odors that are actively being exhausted out of the facility removed. In terms of the question around water, cannabis can be a water demanding crop. If one of the mechanisms that we typically recommend most of our growers to use is a condensate collection technique or technology, in which when you are collecting all of your water that's being transpired and recovered through a dehumidifier or through fan coils, you will then be able to remove any of the impurities and treat it either through ultraviolet light or ozone, and then be able to recycle the water back into the facility. So you can use minimal amounts of water. I don't know which cultivation strategy they're using. We're big fans of using a living soil system, and in fact promote the living soil that Neil and Shannon LeBlanc produce in Wedgeport. And that system uses a minimal amount of water in which you can actually recover that water quite efficiently.
Thank you.
Dave?
Yes.
Dave? So a typical plant uses about what? A liter and a half a day?
Yes, it will. We typically will feed most plants about a liter and a half a day, and a plant will transpire about 90% of that in 24 hours.
So that's about a gallon a minute per day, right? For a micro, let's say we have 2,000 plants, right? Let's say we have 2,000 plants at a liter, you know, plus a plant.
Yeah.
That's 4,000 to 5,000 liters. So that's is roughly a gallon a minute, which is not a whole lot of water.
I actually wouldn't know the amount of water it requires, but you would you'd probably have closer to about 1,200 plants if you were fully using your 200 square meters. Most people wouldn't have 2,000 plants, they'd have closer to 1,200 or less.
Just use 2,000 just to
sure.
Just to have a higher per scale, yes. Yeah. So in terms of the water use, I believe it would be, I think that's more of a private conversation. I don't think it has anything to do with the municipality. So we would have to have a conversation with B and with the other users of the wells.
We don't want to have anybody go dry, so we're going to do whatever we have to do to make things work.
How are you doing?
Good.
I want to make it very clear. I wish you well in your new endeavor, and I support you. All right. The only thing that we have that I'm concerned, like we got way up across inshore, that one, Reg just said, this full capacity, all we can pump out of there. So there is. A well doesn't cost that much to make on your property. And if the staff is too much, I have a couple here that are God knows how many rings that you could take water off. I want to see you stuck. How's that?
Good.
Good. Councillor Surratt.
I'd like to give this question to Jared. Mr. Singh, I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Mr. Singh said that it should mitigate all the smell. And that word is should. Do we have something in the in our bylaws or the municipal MPS that says that if the smell is there, that we can shut it down?
Through you, so you don't in your land use bylaw necessarily, so you rely on the Federal Act requirements for that, which is frankly much stronger impetus in this case than something you would typically have. So there is a process that Mr. Singh mentioned that you basically make a complaint to the Industry Canada, although they've changed names now. Basically to the federal government, and then municipalities can also do that as well. So I would likely direct you to use kind of the formal process they actually have already developed, both for the public and for municipalities.
Jared, is that there's a development agreement, right?
So this isn't a development agreement, it's just a rezoning. If you were going to prepare a development agreement, like we do require that for like a standard production facility, you could impose additional like infractions essentially against things like that as part of that development agreement process.
Deputy Warden, just one more comment and I'll be
absolutely
done.
Sure.
By the way, Sherman and Owen, I wish you all the best. I'm just asking the question.
Thank you, Councillor Surratt. Any other questions or comments? Councillor D'Entremont.
I got a question for, I'm not sure it'd be Jared or Mr. Singh. First of all, I'd like to, I'm the councillor for District 9, which is in the area where this proposal is being made for. And I have to, full disclosure, I am close personal friends with Sherman, not so close personal friend with Owen, but I know him very well. So just so everybody knows that. I know during this, this waiting period for the public hearing, nobody approached me, and I was kind of, taken back by that. But I figured, somebody would at least talk to me about it. But I think it's a small town, and people maybe thought that since I was, good friends with Sherman, that nobody dared ask me any questions. But I sure hope that they wouldn't be afraid of asking. But just so I'm clear on all the levels, it's basically falls under federal jurisdiction when it comes to the the laws that kind of govern it. Does that make sense, you guys?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can clarify a bit of that. So basically, as a municipality, what your current land use bylaw regulates is essentially building setbacks, like size, the use that you'd have in them, things like that. Because this is a federally regulated use, there's also a number of requirements that the federal government stipulates that they have to do as part of operation rather than like being tied necessarily to like a development permit, which is what you typically do as part of a municipality, right? Either a development permit or a development agreement, like he was mentioning. Really on the operation side, mostly it'll be tied to the federal requirements, the actual building size and footprint, things like that. It's a combination of both. So they kind of get layered on one top of the other that they have to meet. So both the municipalities requirements as well as the federal Cannabis Act requirements.
Any provincial jurisdiction there at all?
Not that I'm aware of. There may be, but it'd be less on the land use side, I believe, unless Mr. Singh wants to provide some context for that. It tends to leave my desk after the building gets made.
Deputy Warden, if I may.
Absolutely.
Just following up on Jared's comments, the Health Canada regulations or under the Cannabis Act, the regulations around where you set up a facility are pretty limited. What they're really looking for is to make sure that you are not setting up your facility adjacent to an area where youth would congregate. So we try to stay away from schools, playgrounds, fields, as well as churches. Other than that, it does become more of a provincial and or municipal regulation around decision making of where a site is located. So New Brunswick has a provincial decision where they will only allow for, I believe, cannabis facilities to happen in industrial areas. And then, for example, Halifax Regional Municipality will not allow cannabis operations within HRM unless they're on industrial zones. And then municipalities can have setbacks which vary between the position of the building and a residential house. Most ones that I'm aware of all across Canada are about 50 meters from the corner of one building to the corner of a residential house. Hope that helps, Councillor Don.
Yeah, I'm always intrigued with the three levels of government, so I just wanted to know how they all interacted. Thank you.
Excellent. Anybody else? Councillor Digdon.
Thank you. I guess in all fairness, I should speak a little bit. I am the neighboring counselor to Mr. D'Entremont. And I received a few opinions about this proposed business. But I also, knowing Sherman and knowing Owen, I honestly believe they would be good corporate citizens. I believe that they're gonna try and mitigate any odors that's coming off of that plant if it gets approved and if they go ahead with it. And I will say, after tonight, no matter what way we go, it puts a counselor in a spot, and I'm not scared to be put in a spot, and it doesn't bother me to put in this spot, folks. But as a municipality, here we are going through all the right steps, and given time for people to come and make presentations if they're against it. And we've had none here this evening that I know of against it, you know, and even had the wishes of the business owner across the road, wishing them the best of luck and that. So anyway, whatever council votes on this evening, whether I vote with it or against it, I will be around tomorrow in Pubnico, folks. So, and I'm approachable. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Donaldson?
Yes. I made this clear the last time we talked on this subject. This is strictly a vote for council to rezone the land. Is that correct?
Yes.
It's nothing to do with whether we agree with them, with the business, or if the community agrees or disagrees. It's totally to rezone a piece of land.
This would be to pass the second reading of that. Right.
Okay. Question for Sherman and Owen. If for some reason, which I'm going to support rezoning the land myself, what the rest of the council does is up to them. But if for some reason that it wasn't rezoned, do you have a plan B for another site where you wouldn't have to go through this?
We currently don't have a plan B. We have plan A, B, and C at one point, but now we're sticking to this one. And we're just hoping it goes through. We still have our ears open and eyes in case this wouldn't go through, but we don't have a definite plan B as of now.
Yeah. In my mind, your operation, what you're going to be doing there, to me, is a business that is less intrusive than fish plants, in my opinion, in welding shops. So, I mean, I can't see where you're going to be any corporate problem for anybody around you. So that's just my opinion.
It's just it's just a new industry. It's a new business, and there's still that stigma, around cannabis, of course, but because it's only been legal for a couple of years, we want to go through the right steps, and we want to go through, the licensing process, and we're going to do everything in our power to make this going the right way and be good neighbors. Yes.
Okay, I'm all done. And just one quick question. When you're fully operational, I mean, it's got nothing to do with the decision, but how many employees are you looking at?
Typically, one master grower and probably two or three helpers at certain times. Ave, is that correct?
I would imagine that you would have three sort of full-time employees, and then when you are ready to process your flower for sale, you might hire a few extras to come in, harvest, and trim your flower.
Thank you, Mrs. Chairman, for letting me stray off the subject, but I'm just curious.
That's fine. No, those are good questions. Anyone else?
Yeah, rezoning, B.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right, I think I understand what you mean. Just as long as the rest of the land is still industrial and marine, and that doesn't change, right? Am I right what I'm saying?
Yes.
The only rezoning is going to be on that property there.
Right.
All right. That's one thing, yeah. As far as workers, don't talk about employees to me, because we've got all kinds of room here for employees. We can't find that. Good luck finding employees, guys.
QB, thanks.
Are there any other comments or questions? Okay, seeing none, I'll hand it over to Jared again.
Okay, just present the recommendation that council give second reading and approve the rezoning of a portion of property along Desert Point Road, Lower West Pubnico, PID 900-811-42 from marine industrial to light industrial zone.
Thank you. Are there any final questions or comments from councillors? Okay. Once this meeting ends, council will begin the council meeting, where a motion will be made on the application later on in the agenda. You can watch the meeting on the Municipality of Argyle Facebook site if you would like. And that concludes tonight's public hearing. Thank you. Thanks everybody for your participation. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll just bring up my agenda again. So we will now go into our committee of the whole meeting for March 30th. I'd like to call our committee of the whole meeting to order and welcome everybody again. Has everybody had a chance to look at the agenda? Is there anything anybody would like to add? If not, can I have somebody approve the agenda? Can I have a motion to approve the agenda? So moved by Richard, Councillor Donaldson, seconded by Councillor Glenn Digdon. All those in favor signify by raising your hand or saying aye. Contrary minded? Are you contrary, Calvin? No. Okay. All right. motion carried. Thank you. I just want to mention that you will notice we have a member who has sent regrets. Our warden has had a medical procedure, so he is out for a little bit and we wish him a speedy recovery. Are there any conflicts of interest to declare tonight? Yes, Councillor Donald.
I don't think it's a conflict of interest, but as I was saying in the public hearing, but of course everybody wasn't watching public hearing, when it's going to come to the item 5A, which is the second reading land use bylaw amendment, I just wanted to full disclosure that the two applicants are personal friends of mine, but I have no monetary or investment in that business or anything like that. But just to declare it that I am friends with those guys. So
that's good. Just putting it on the table.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Sounds good. Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, I'm just going to move my agenda over here. All right, next on the agenda, number three, we have the adoption of minutes. So for 3A, we have regular council meeting minutes from March 9th, 2021. Is there somebody who would be willing to move them? Councillor Surrett, thank you. Seconder, Councillor Saunier. Any questions on that? Okay, all those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary, you can raise your hand. Motion carried. We have our special council meeting minutes from March 18th, 2021. Somebody willing to make a motion to move those minutes? Councillor Donaldson, thank you. And seconded by Councillor Bourque. Any questions on that? Okay, all those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary minded, you can raise your hand. Thank you, motion carried. Next we have in the business arising from the minutes. If you notice in 4A, we have Bell signed agreement. So this is an agreement that's already been signed. It's basically for information, just to let you know that the contract has been signed and that work can soon commence on this project. Am I correct on that, CAO Muse?
You are correct. It is okay. For your information, this council has already approved this commitment. It is to confirm that the contract is signed and that the work will commence as quickly as Bell can commence the work.
Okay, any discussion, any questions about that? Councillor Surratt.
This is just a comment. They were in Surratt Zali in the Tittle Road measuring lines today. I saw the truck and talked to them. That's it, thank you.
Excellent, it's exciting. Okay, number five for decision and discussion. So 5A is the second reading of the land use bylaw amendment. So it's just exactly what we had been talking about. There was a recommendation. I'm trying to find it. Oh, goodness. I'm looking for it. So we're looking to pass the second reading. We need to make a motion to pass the second reading of the amendment of the land use bylaw. I can't find this recommendation. Oh, there it is. So recommend that council give second reading and approve amendments to the land use bylaw to rezone a portion of the subject site along Dennis Point Road, PID 900-81142, from marine industrial zone to light industrial zone to enable a micro cannabis production processing facility. There is a recommended motion. Does everybody have that in front of them? Yes, okay. So is there somebody willing to make the motion to pass second reading?
Go for it, Calvin.
Oh, he's a little bit afraid, I think, because of the, yeah. Councillor Donaldson, you're willing to make that motion? Do we have a seconder?
Sorry, Calvin.
That's okay. Councillor Surrett seconded. Questions or comments on that motion? Councillor D'Antremo.
Yeah, I guess you know, the discussion that I could say that Councillor, myself and Councillor Dignan had before this meeting was that you know, we were concerned about the smell. There's a restaurant nearby. We didn't really know all the details, and we still don't know the details. Here in Lower West Pubnico, we've had a few incidents where we've had you know, people, I guess, experts in the field. Saying that you know, this thing wasn't going to smell. I'll use the example of the sewer plant. We've had you know, two times that we thought that we wouldn't have any smell from the sewer plant, which that wasn't didn't turn out true or did not work or whatever. And then we had the dewatering truck, which we had problems, which had been promised by experts or people who in that field that would work for us, but did not. So that was, you know, two black eyes there. So, you know, I guess I'm a little leery about when it comes to smells. Now, when it comes to the rezoning of this land and you know, for the use of a cannabis production plant or whatever you want to call it, I guess I was figuring that there would be way more people who would come forward with written statements or, you know, at the public hearing. But as you can see, there is Mr. B. D'Antremo, who, you know, was just giving his concerns, and he has the business right across the road, which is true. He does keep, you know, everything tidy and everything there is, you know, right in order and just no smells. So, you know, we definitely, you know, definitely know why he was concerned, but he obviously endorsed them. So I guess where I'm coming at is, you know, we were kind of thinking about maybe deferring at that time after hearing everybody's opinion and to maybe, you know, go to a production plant and, you know, basically to have a look for ourselves to see if it smells or not. But I guess if the public is not concerned, well, I'm not too concerned either right now. So anyway, thank you.
Anyone else? Councillor Sonia.
Thank you. My question is more procedural. Does passing this bylaw set a precedent as far as someone else making the same application in another community, or is each application done independently?
Well, I think part of that, if I can, and please somebody correct me if I'm wrong, it all depends on the use of where they want the land use of where they want to put that facility, right? In this case, we just had to amend the bylaw so that they could put it on that type of land use. So if Ted, they begin and they're in the right land, in the right zone, we don't even have to go through this process. It's just because we're making an amendment. Am I right in saying that?
Okay. Yes, 100%. Okay. So I would perhaps add maybe some clarification, if I may. Mm-hmm. So this is for rezoning. So they aren't required to come forward with detailed design, like floor plans, or like even necessarily an odor control strategy or anything along those lines, right? So it's really more or less looking at the policies of the municipal plan. Those are really geared towards cohesion of industrial areas. So you have a marine industrial region, essentially, that's in that zone right now, which you're looking to rezone to another industrial zone, which is a light industrial, right? So that's really kind of the question in terms of like the policy piece that basically obligated to review in some manner as part of these rezoning applications. I'd like to recenter it back to that, because that really is kind of the question at the end of the day. There might be a larger question for us to go back from a staff side and do amendments to how we kind of do review these applications. But currently, if you bought up a property that's light industrial zone now, assuming all the setbacks are met and so on, he could come forward for a development permit from the development officer, like no no meetings or public hearings or things like that required, just for context for everybody.
Right. Thank you. Okay. Anybody else? Seeing nobody.
Question.
Thank you. Question's been called. We have a motion on the floor. All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Contrary minded, raise your hand. Motion carried. Thank you. Okay. We are at 5B, relief of interest. So especially, I guess, for the new counselors, I'm not sure how many times we've done this since the new counselors have been on council, but every once in a while we get some properties that we make a motion to relieve the interest on for various reasons. And you have a document that was sent to you. There are three properties. The only question I have, CAO Muse, is do we have to do each of them individually or can we chunk them all together?
Madam Chair, Deputy Warden, we can do them all together in one motion as long as we say the amount, and seeing as the attachment is there, it would be obvious that what you're approving. I will note that of the three that are showing as write-offs, all three are coding errors. None of them should have had interest coded to those accounts. So those are coding errors that are system errors that we're looking to, that we have fixed, but there is a balance that remains. Right. And that's why we're looking to write it off.
Okay, thank you. Is Councillor Bourque, you have a question?
No, it's not a question. I'll make the motion that we relieve the interest on the Wellington turbine of $1,443.90 and on the black easement on the Black Pond Road, 2858, and the West Pubnico Fire Department insurance and dues, I guess that's if I'm correct, $76.35 for a total of $1,548.83.
Excellent. Thank you. Do we have a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Surratt. Questions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary, raise your hand. Motion carried. Thank you. Next, Iris Communications, extension of contract. So there are two attachments with this one. And what I understand, this was the firm, I guess, the communication firm that we had hired for fishing public relations. I'm not sure if you remember that a few months ago, we had hired them and we're looking to extend their contract for a minimum of 3 months, 3 to 6 months is what I believe. So we need them, if we agree to do that, and there's also the cost sharing funding formula comparison that was given. So what it's going to cost as well. So if we are interested in doing that, we need to make a motion to do so. What is the wish of council? Councilor Surratt, you want to make that motion? Yes. Do we have a seconder? Councilor D'Entremont? Do we have any questions or comments about that? Okay, seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye or raising your hand. Contrary minded, nay, raise your hand. Motion carried. Excellent. Okay, next, splash pad contribution. And so for the splash pad contribution, there were two attachments. The first one was the presentation that we saw less than a month ago, hasn't been that long. We also had, the request for decision that was submitted by our CAO. So if you'll permit me, I'm just going to talk a little bit about this because I am on the splash pad committee. So this work has been going on for probably a year and a half to 2 years. And I'm not sure if you remember the members of the splash pad made a presentation much earlier in stages in this project. And at that time, our council felt like we didn't have all the information that we needed. So we asked them some more questions. We asked them to kind of go back and dig deeper. And a lot of it was around numbers, around funding. So they went back and did some research and they came back and did their second presentation. So some of the things I would just like to mention is that so in the request for proposal, you will see, first of all, that the total cost to build this will be about right around $350,000. and they're going to cut that into thirds. So a third of that project, they're looking for federal and provincial grants. A third of that project will be funded by fundraising, because there has been a great demand in the community, interest in the community. And the other third, they want to take that and cut that into thirds. So a third by us, a third by the municipality of Yarmouth, and a third from the town of Yarmouth. So that the ask to us is going to be $38,777, because I can't say it right now. overall, the operation cost, they're kind of thinking it's going to be around $20,000 a year for operation, and that's on the high end. Now, I do want to say that there's been a lot of work done around this project. So Mark Brophy, the town engineer, has helped kind of determine the best site for this. The specific site, you need to know that the specific site for this project hasn't yet been chosen. It will be on the Mariner Center site. They're feeling that the best position is along the Jody Shelley Drive, because having worked with the town engineer, that's where all the piping, it's the best location for it, and it will not affect the Mariner Center expansion either. I know we had some information today about some wind-ish concerns about wind studies and things of that nature. So I dug a little bit deeper as well in talking with the committee. We do actually have a meeting tomorrow night, but so if you think about the location of that, it's actually kind of behind the Mariner Center building. And then on the other side of the road, there are trees, and there's the water shoots from the bottom and comes up. So wind won't necessarily affect that. And I think about wind, and I think about the beach, and I think about wind not really affecting kids at the beach, because the water is freezing at Port Maitland Beach and kids keep going, still go in the water. I know there's still some people that aren't 100% sure about this. I've been on the committee from the beginning. I feel like it would be a great addition. The closest one is Shelburne or Middleton. We have a member on our committee that her husband is a doctor. And when we talk about doctor recruitment, one of the things that she will say often is that her husband says, we don't have enough things for people to do around here. And that's why she's on the committee, and she's kind of pushed for this. So I'm thinking that those are the biggest things that I wanted to talk about, but I'm going to open it up. Questions, comments from other counselors. And the other two municipal units did agree to the funding request. Councilor Surratt.
I've read the whole thing a couple of times, and looking at it, and I see that there's nothing wrong with this, that the town is going to benefit, and the town is going to benefit out of this, because there's be people traveling into the army, going to the splash park, and good for them. And so, having said that, you know, there'll be people going to eat, there'll be people going shopping, and there'll be good people possibly going for gas, people coming from outside different municipalities, they'll be coming in, you can be guaranteed. So my objection, I'm not against the splash park. I want to be sure that I'm understood clearly here. What I'm against is the amount. I think that our 20, as our CAO has put on our the attachments, we're 20.9%, roughly that would be 24,000. And that's the number that I've come up with looking at things, and I think our share shouldn't be more than 24,000. It's a sticking point on my part. I feel that the one-third doesn't represent what our use will be. And probably one question will go to the CAO. You had put in your in the attachment the survey. What did you mean by the survey, which showed that we are 20.9%?
Through you, Madam Chair, Councillor Surratt, the survey is in reference to the presentation done by the nonprofit committee. If you note, I don't recall the page. There's a circle ratio, like it looks the percentages. And of the respondents that responded to their survey, the number of 20% came from that survey. So it was their survey. So essentially, you know, look, it's an indication of who answered the survey. It may or may not be an indication of who actually uses the facility, but I thought the information was useful and very very proactive on the part of the nonprofit organization.
Thank you very much. I'll just say this one last comment. I'm willing to support 24,000. I you know, plus the maintenance in the year, but I can't support the 38. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Any other comments? Councillor Donaldson.
Yeah, my comments are exactly on the same line as what Councillor Surratt brought up, Ben. I think of the usage of the YMCA when it was in operation. The public in Argyle used it. Our usage was around 20%. I can't see it being any higher for a splash park, probably even lower, because I can't picture people from the Pumnicos and the Argyles jumping in the car, the ride the whole way to Yarmouth just to go to a splash park. It may be part of another part of their reason to go to Yarmouth, but if you live in Yarmouth or surrounding area, you can follow your kids on in the car or vehicle, take them to the splash park, go home, come back, pick them up. People from 30, 40, 50 kilometers away don't have that option. So I don't think our usage is going to represent one third. That's my concern. I'm fully in favor of building that, but I wish it was in Glenwood Park. But
we're getting there. That,
did you? Or maybe a park somewhere would be better than the Mariner Center. I don't know, but I don't think Argyle's going to use it a third. So I'm with Guy. I don't even know if I'd go 24%, but I probably will. But I think it will be lower than that. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Digdon?
Thank you. First question I'd like to ask our CAO, whether we go 24,000 or 38,000, that do we have the money to do that? That extra money to put out there right now and the money to keep it up?
Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
So a technical issue there. Okay. Well, I mean, I think it's, you know, we certainly have access to that amount of money. I think in light of our conversations last week on strategic planning and some of the things that we may want to do in our own communities, et cetera, there's always a choice. And, you know, how we prioritize those choices, certainly we do our best to try to prioritize them or assist you to prioritize them as they're your choices. I would suggest that if you are interested in this project and you feel like you want to be a partner on this project, the amount we can certainly budget for and get. I would point out that we did recently receive an announcement of a doubling of gas tax. That was an unexpected announcement. So as this is a recreation asset, I suspect that, you know, I can't confirm 100%, but my strong suspicion is that it would be eligible for gas tax funding for that purpose. Certainly, if you chose not to use gas tax, we would find a way through our capital reserves, which we put aside money every year, to fund this if that was in your interest to do so. But I mean, your question is well-founded, because I think it's, you know, when I hear that question, I often ask that question individually. The things that we do generally at that magnitude, we're usually okay if council wishes to do that. It's when it gets bigger and when you start adding a lot of them together, it's at that point that it becomes a little bit more concerning for us as staff. So I hope that answers your question. It's a hard one to answer entirely or directly because I feel like the question is asking about other projects as well. Like there's an inherent undertone of the question, but this one alone, on its own, yes, we can certainly do that.
Councillor Sonia.
Thank you. I have a tendency to agree with Councillor Surratt's funding. I'm not quite convinced yet to go that low. However, when it comes to the demographics, Plymouth is probably the closest community to Yarmouth. And I've heard some feedback on that. They would love a splash park. We only are 5, 6, 7 minutes from town. So it's pretty natural for us to access town compared to Pubnico. I get it. And to Deputy Warden's point of doctor recruitment, which is one of my huge concern, I think that has to be behind our mind and behind our thoughts when we vote for this, because that's important for everybody. And to make this area attractive, we might have to make a few sacrifices as well. Thank you.
Councillor Bourque, thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm just wondering if we don't say we don't vote to go for this, will the municipality of Yarmouth and the town, will they go forward anyway? That's just a question I have.
That's a great question, but I don't have an answer to be honest. I'm really not certain about that. I'm pretty certain that the committee won't go back and ask for more money. I feel like this was the ask. They're not going to go back and say we need more. This is a one-time kind of request, and that's it. And I felt like they're not going to come back 3 months from now and say, oh, we made a mistake and we need more money. That's not at all what they're going to do. But in terms of will the other two continue on, I really don't know.
Madam Chair, from an administrative perspective, I don't have the answer to that question either. Yeah. So we don't know. It will depend on their will to continue.
Councillor Donaldson.
The federal, provincial, and fundraising aspects of this, they're not there yet, are they? So this is the first step of funding. So
right.
I mean, this is a long ways from a go.
Yes.
As we speak now. So yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Councillor Digdon?
Pull the trigger on this one. Being as though, I feel as though that the Yarmouth people living in the Yarmouth and closer to the Yarmouth area will have more usage out of this than a lot of people in the municipality of Argyle. And being as though I feel as though there's going to be some associated benefits to the businesses in Yarmouth, having this splash park in there if it goes ahead. And also I know there's some fundraising being done or going to be done. I feel as though maybe the businesses in Yarmouth may be able to put in a little more money in that. I'd be willing to make a motion that the municipality of Argyle donate $25,000 towards the splash park project in Yarmouth.
Do we have a seconder? Councillor Surrett, any other questions or comments on that? Okay, seeing none, all those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary minded, raise your hand. Motion carried. Okay, thank you everybody. Next, we have Mariner Center Strategic Plan. So this is this is for information. Let me see. Do we need to? So have you had the chance to look at the strategic plan? So do we make a motion on this one, CEO? I forget about that. Yeah.
We do. Yeah. This one is the request is to endorse. Right. I would note that a lot of you have had an input on this because some of you as board members and some of you as elected officials, this certainly represents the days that Max Chauvin led the strategic planning of the Mariner Center. And I can, because it's in front of you, it means that the board for the Mariner Center has approved it and is looking for you to endorse.
So we're looking for an endorsement of this plan. Councillor Digdon?
Thank you. And just for full disclosure, again, I do sit on the management board of the Mariner Center, just so people will know that.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yep. What is the wish of council? Do we want to make a motion to endorse this? Councillor Surrett, yes, you want to make that motion? Do we have a seconder? Councillor Bourque, thank you. CAO Muse, yes?
Just on the question, not yet. just on the question, I just want to be, and I'm not being an alarmist. I just want to make it very clear that upon endorsing the strategic plan, the responsibility of the plan lies with the board primarily. Mm-hmm. As owners, however, you should be aware that in this plan, they're going to have priorities, and those priorities are going to come up, and those priorities may require funding requests. The endorsement of the plan doesn't mean that you're endorsing carte blanche all of these recommendations that the Mariner Center board may receive. Ultimately, you are you're a non-owner of the Mariner Center as the municipality. You're a member of the board. We have two memberships, actually, three, in fact, and not including non-voting. So we have representation of the board, but we're not an owner of the Mariners Center. And as you will see in the in-camera element of our agenda, I do have the agreement for the Mariner Center funding attached. Just to say that we need to renew. And so the discussion on that will be in camera. But the current recommendation is a third, a third, a third funding, even if we're a non-owner. So the operational consequences of endorsing this plan, I just want you to be aware that there could be things that come down the pipe from a financial perspective that you'll have to consider. But it does not mean that you're committed financially moving forward because you've endorsed this plan. The strategic plan is also designed to increase revenues and increase activity at the Mariner Center as well. So I just like to say that a little bit, because I find sometimes we might go a little quickly on these and we approve it, and then a year later we see the priorities and go, well, where did that come from? So keep an eye on this one, because every year, and Duram's going to do an excellent job at this, he is going to do what those priorities are for the current year, and he's going to wrap costs and revenues associated with each of those.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Any other questions or concerns on that? Okay, so we have a motion on the floor. All those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary minded, raise your hand. Good, motion carried. Thank you. Next, we have the accessibility committee member. So we have we had a discussion about this at a prior meeting. Councillor Digdon is currently the member of the accessibility committee, and Warden Muse is the alternate. So if you recall, Councillor Digdon had mentioned that he was struggling to make it to the meetings and felt like really he should not be the main person. And then that would mean it was going to fall on Warden Muse. And Warden Muse felt like he has enough commitments as it is. So he really doesn't want to be the main committee member. So we're looking for somebody new to take on the accessibility committee. So we need basically the main member for that committee. Is there somebody who is interested in being a member of that committee? Councillor D'Entremont.
When do they have meetings? Or
I believe it's during the day, is it, Councillor Digdon? And it's a monthly meeting?
That is my, and again, I'm sorry that I'm looking for someone to take this over, because anyone that knows me, when I go into something or whatever, I go into it with all my heart and with both feet. The meetings are at 9 o'clock usually in the morning, and they're going to be starting meetings twice a month instead of once a month. So it was just very, very hard for me to commit to it the way I'd like to be able to commit to it. And that's why I'm hoping that somebody else that has a lot of time, or that has some time, or more time than what I have lately, will step up. Thank you.
Yeah, the 9 o'clock in the morning for me is not a good time. So.
CAO Muse.
Just further context, it's true that we'll be meeting more often as the project accelerates. we're trying to finish the work by September of 2021, which would be earlier than the deadline imposed by government. And so once that work is done, there still would be a need for an accessibility committee, but it would be ad hoc. It would not meet nearly as much, and it may change its time and date. The reason why we meet so early in the morning is one of our members is from Australia. And so for that purpose, they joined via Zoom. So then I would suggest that counselors, if they were not able to attend in person, we certainly could accommodate Zoom because we're already accommodating it for our Australian member.
Councillor Boudreaux?
Just wondering, I mean, I'd love to jump in, but I mean, two meetings every month at 9 o'clock, I'm too busy for that. Why wouldn't that one member from Australia change her time that she can Zoom at 6 o'clock in the evening?
We can certainly look into that. I think the time difference at 9 means that she's joining us at, I believe, 11 a.m. or perhaps 12 midnight. I don't have an answer to that question. We haven't asked her specifically that question. But certainly, you know, if she was more available in the morning, Australian time morning, that might make sense. We did try to accommodate other members as well, and that seemed to be the right time, but we might be able to make changes.
How many members are on this committee? I mean, we've got a tend to her needs, while there's probably, you know, 7 or 8 other people on this committee. You know what I mean? Not to offend her by any means. It's just that we're tending to her schedule, I guess.
Right, and maybe I wasn't, like, I think it was an agreed upon time, so I don't necessarily want to land all of that on her, but we know that it's challenging sometimes to get members that are either have disabilities themselves or work in the arena of helping people with disabilities or have family members. And so, you know, we've been mindful of that for sure. But look, I mean, if time is an issue, we could go back to that committee and see if there are other times that work.
Yeah, that'd be great. And I'd be interested, no problem, but I can't do it at 9 o'clock, you know, twice a month.
Councillor Sonia?
Looks like I'm the only one available. I'm retired and I guess I can make it. My only question is this, I was told this was live. It's not via Zoom.
It can be both.
Right. It's mostly live. I think the member from Australia usually Zooms in, right? For obvious reasons. But the understanding is if a counselor wanted to Zoom in, they could.
Yeah,
no, in some ways morning's better for me than evening at times. So I guess I'll pitch in.
So you're willing to put your name. Okay.
Sure.
Thank you, Councillor Sonia. We need a motion for that, CAO Muse. Okay, so can we have, lots of hands just went up there. Councillor Surratt will make the motion to appoint Councillor Sonia to the Accessibility Committee, and it was seconded by Councillor Bourque. Are there any questions, comments? All those in favor signify by raising your hand.
Thank you.
Contrary minded, raise your hand. Motion carried. Thank you, Councillor Sonia.
You're welcome.
I'm sure you feel better, Councillor Digdon.
Thank you, Ted.
I've got one more question.
Yes.
The CR in front of our names on these committees.
Let me take
What's
a look
at CR stand for?
Current, I think.
Okay.
Does that make sense? So our names, the names that are next to the Is that what that would mean? CR stand for current, the current member?
It's short for counselor.
Counselor.
It's there really short for counselor.
Thank you.
You'll see on the second page, it says CRS Glenn Digdon and Guy Surette for the Heritage Advisor. That was the hint for me.
Okay. Sounds good. 5G solar project. So we have three attachments for the solar project. The first one is the explanation of the proposal to design and install the photovoltaic system at the Willett Road Water Tower. So it explains the project. There is another attachment which gives basically the revenue that would be generated if we were able to sell that power. And the third attachment is the request for proposal. Well, can't spit it out. So looking at this, we talked about this in the past. So this is a change. It's basically a change of location. We had already approved this project. It's just we're changing the location from Wedgeport to East Pubnico. And we would be able, so the cost would be $275,000. Is that correct, CAO Muse? And we would generate some revenue from that over time. So for the next, it would be all about $26,500 a year for the next 18 years in revenue. Is that correct?
Yes, the 275 represents the budgeted amount. Actual amount is less, but there may be some additional costs that will bring it to that number.
Right.
Right now, the contract that we're looking to sign is below the budget. There may be some fencing and other additional costs that we may have to add on, but I think we'll be close to, if not within budget, for sure. And you know, for council's information, you will be. There is an attachment, a spreadsheet attachment that shows the approximate revenues and expenses. Mm-hmm. One of the things that you should note on that is it includes a repayment of loan. So it makes the assumption that you've borrowed money to do the project. Well, you didn't.
Right.
You used your gas tax to do that. And mm-hmm. and my logic around that is that even if we use that instead of borrowing, I don't consider that the same thing. I don't look at gas tax as being something that we owe back to ourselves. So essentially, in short, it means that the taxpayer will benefit to the tune of about $25,000 a year in profit over the 18-year period. It will start up higher, but then it tapers over time. Mm-hmm. And after the 18-year period, it's possible that will continue, but I don't know what that looks like.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, Councilor Dottrell.
Yeah, I guess for me, it's another exciting project in the municipality. We just had our strategic planning session at the Argala where we spoke about 20 years down the road, 2041, solar came out, all these alternative power sources. And, as far as I'm concerned, that's, this is a great project. It's, taking us in that direction. In another part of the municipality, it'd be nice to have, solar in every district, in every community in the municipality. Mm-hmm. And other alternative power sources, so it's the wave of the future. Thank you.
For sure. Thank you. So there, yes, Councillor Surette.
A couple of questions. I'll add on the financial end of it, where you got year one to year 18, a couple of questions. O&M. Operation and maintenance.
You got it.
I see that energy production in kilowatts seems to go down from year one to year 18. Is there a reason for that?
Yes. Over time, the panels they diminish in quality. So I think these estimates are probably conservative based on what we've seen the others You know, they don't want to oversell the ability of these panels. But what we've seen with both of them in West Pubnico is that they have outdone their estimates, at least at the beginning. Obviously, you know, you can't predict all the sunny days, et cetera. So there is some averaging out that happens. But yeah, the quality of the panels fade over time.
And Madam Chair, one more question. Alain, do you, I was looking, trenching, fencing, switches, breakers, and stuff like that. So I, my question was, how much more money are we looking at? $275,000, but maybe you've answered that already by saying, I believe I heard you say that we should not, even with the fencing, trenching, switches, breakers, we probably won't go over to $275,000. And that's just for my information, I guess.
Right. I can assure you that we won't exceed $275,000 because some of that, but I'm very confident that we'll be within budget. And so the electrical switch, I can say that it's really good timing because we're doing a lot of work on the East Pubnico water utility and it could use a new electrical three-phase switch in. So it just so happened to be extraordinarily, that's luck is what that is at the end of the day. So we will seek to claim that under one or the other project, but we won't have to pay for it twice. And the fencing itself is not obligatory. Once we install it, we may make a decision not to fence it, or we could fence it in a different way that could be quite a bit less expensive. So I'm realizing that it's fenced in at our admin building. But knowing there's a lot of traffic and other factors that might come into play. You know, if we had a high concern for vandalism, then we may make those decisions. So I think we'll engage with our local councillor in that area, as well as the fire departments to understand what their needs might be. And based on that, we'll make a decision. So the fencing may or may not happen. Obviously, if it doesn't, we'll be way below budget.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
You're welcome. Councillor Bohr?
Thank you, Chair. It always shines in East Pubnico, so there'll be a lot of power generated. go ahead. So this is great. This is what we need, and it's mentioned before. Every community, every village should have something like this. This is the future. And if I'm permitted to do the motion. I guess the motion is that the CEO signed the contract with Thermodynamics for the design and installation of the solar panels at Willett Road Water Tower in East Pubnico.
Thank you. Do we have a seconder? Councillor D'Entremont seconded. Any questions on that? Comments? Councillor Digdon?
Thank you. Just one thing I'm thinking about, maybe they've already looked at it. Would there be any room on the roof of the East Pubnico Fire Hall for these panels? Like, I know they went with them a couple of places here in West Pubnico. Just wondering.
Councillor Digdon, that was absolutely one of the locations that they analyzed. But and certainly there may or may not have been room for, I can't remember the reason why they eliminated it. But I think that the one thing I know about on-ground solar is that they can point them exactly the way they want to point them. And so I suspect some of the decision to be on that location was to maximize the revenue generation.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions or comments?
I was surprised, Madam Chair, that nobody asked if the fence would be electric. I thought I'd throw that in. The answer is no.
All right, we have a motion on the floor. Okay, are we ready to vote on the motion? Awesome. All those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary minded, raise your hand. Motion carried. Thank you. All right, we're zipping through. We are at H. Kilometers and transportation allowance rate change effective April 1st, 2021. So you have an attachment that shows how there are changes. Every once in a while, we see that the rate for mileage, it changes. So there will be a change on April 1st. And basically we need, for this one, we need a motion to accept these changes and that these will be the changes that our municipality adopts when it comes to mileage. Okay. Any comments, questions?
I would add that it's already in your policy, but we do, as practice, we do a motion every year so that council's aware of the change.
Right. Councilor Bourque.
I just make the motion that we, I guess we accept this.
Seconder?
Effective 1st of April.
Thank you. Do we have a seconder? Councillor Digdon? Thank you. Thank you. Any questions or comments? Councillor Digdon?
Thank you. And I believe that rate increases just keeping up with the provincial rate, is it not?
Right. It's, yeah. And it happens.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes. Thank you.
It's not us making the changes.
No.
All right.
It's not us making the changes for our municipality, but right. Keeping up the provincial rate.
Motion on the floor. Any questions or comments? Okay. All those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary minded, raise your hand. Motion carried. Good. Financial statement. Okay. So I know CAO Muse is dying to talk about this. So we will, 3 minutes or less, go. Just kidding. Go ahead.
That's all I'm going to need, Madam Chair. That's all I'm going to need. As you know, we don't go into great detail unless we go quarterly. So I just want to give you an update. So the first three pages are included. Right now, we're seeing an unrestricted surplus of $277,000. I expect that to continue into March. Obviously, March isn't going to change a ton. From our year. I don't expect any huge surprises. That number could in fact increase with an additional inclusion of COVID funding from the province. What our Director of Finance and I have decided is that we've reflected $38,000 of revenue coming from the COVID safe restart funding from the province, because that's the amount that we could comfortably say that we could claim easily. Most of which, if not all, came from the Mariner Center increased costs, because you know those cost increases were directly attributable to COVID. We will have other costs coming in March, some purchases of electronic equipment, mostly laptops, to accommodate the at-home work situation. Just so happens to be at the same time where some of our computers needed to be replaced, so that was good timing, and so that expense will be about $11,000 or $12,000, because we've got multiple laptops that we were replacing, but it will be offset 100% by the COVID funding. So that's not coming from the municipal tax dollar. It does enable us to do our work from home if we have to, because while many did work from home, we had to make some accommodations. And some of them couldn't because of the computer restrictions that they had. Overall, what you'll see is there's like massive differences in revenues, particularly in return on investments and deed transfer tax. It sounds like a broken record for you now. I'm sure you've heard it more than once. So that is continuing. The deed transfer tax is still strong. It will be our best year ever for deer transfer tax. Yeah, we transferred our deer to the town and
received. We could tax them. We probably make a lot of money on that.
Yeah. So we didn't get paid for the deer transfer tax, but for the deed transfer tax, we definitely got paid. Uh-huh. And so as a consequence, we'll have our best year ever, and we haven't had March yet. So we're already surpassed that. So you know, go figure. COVID. So there are some expenses that are higher than we anticipated, the biggest of which was a grant to organization to the Congrès Mondial 2024. We didn't anticipate to pay them as quickly as we did, but the amount was committed. We had committed an amount over a period of time. So this year we paid 100 and next year we'll pay 50. So that will be in your budget for next year. Other things of items of note would be environmental health services, we have seen some savings, most of which I will say have to do with the fact that we didn't do community litter cleanup last mm-hmm. year. So we anticipated to do it twice during the budget, and then COVID was in the middle of that, and then we ended up not doing it at all. So we are in conversation about how we try to do that this year. We have some safety concerns that are less than COVID, and they're more like safety around, safety of people being in and out of ditches and doing things properly. We've had some safety incidents occur with some of our staff that have increased our level of understanding of what could be in these ditches. So we have to be mindful of the safety of our people. We know it's a very popular event. We get a lot of calls about whether or not we're going to do community litter cleanup this year. So I believe there's a strong interest in that, which means that we're likely to include something in the budget for that next year. But just to explain, that's the major difference between what we actually spent and what we did. So the budget was a little wonky this year. The actuals will start to come back to normal. We're still working on budget for actuals this year. The biggest changes will be the de-transfer tax revenue will come back to what, I don't even know what to call normal, but it will come back to a number that isn't the number we budgeted last year, which was like 50,000. And the other thing is recreation. So we're going to try to get some of those events restored. So that will have an impact because we're increasing our services. Mm-hmm. So we decreased our services and we decreased our revenues last year we decreased our services because we anticipated a reduction in revenue, but the reduction of revenue did not occur. So that's why you're seeing a surplus at that level. Mm-hmm. So, at the end of the year, you're going to see that number at that level or even more. So we're going to have to make some decisions about what that means, how much of that flows into the next year, for instance, how much of that gets invested in projects of your interest, and how much of it gets put aside for the future. And so that will be our budget discussions, which will happen in, less than a month's time. So costs, what we've seen moving forward, the costs to do business are escalating. I think people are noticing that in their own homes, if they're doing any sort of construction. We are anticipating some increases in our CMP and other services that we cannot control. So we have to be mindful of these things as we move forward. And I will say that our service, our request for delivering services to our residents is quite high. Our residents appreciate the services we're doing and they're asking us to deliver a service. So we will be balancing all of these things in the coming months. And that is the report, Council.
Okay, thank you. Any questions for our CAO? Councillor Dottrell.
Not really a question, but just a comment. And as I reflect back to last year, this time when we were starting our budget deliberations with the uncertainty in the world, I do dare say that the resilience of Argyll, of our people, of our staff, I think we fared out pretty good through mm-hmm. all the uncharted waters that, really, there was a lot of uncertainty, and to put a budget together in those times was tough, I know, on our CAO, but we've gone through it, and our residents have, been able to keep working, and we've kept the virus away for most parts, and, I think this year, as we're planning our new budget, even though we have some challenges, at least I feel like we don't have the uncertainty that we had last year. So that's kind of my own opinion, but that's kind of how it is. Yeah. Thanks.
Great comments. Anyone else? Councillor Digdon.
Madam Chair and the rest of council, at this time I'd like to vacate my seat for a little while. I may be back joining the meeting later on this evening. I'm not sure. But if I don't, I will definitely be looking it over on Zoom, YouTube, and making sure that I keep up with what's been said for the rest of the meeting.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions? So we have to make a motion to pass. Do we make a motion to pass this? I can never remember this one. Yes. Okay.
Councilor Smith. To accept.
To accept. Okay. So are we ready for to make a motion to accept the financial statement? Is there somebody willing to make that motion? Councilor Bourque, seconded by Councilor Dodgerall. Any questions on that? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary minded, raise your hand. Excellent. Motion carried. Thank you. Next, we have correspondence and for information. So the first piece in that is a letter of response from the Department of Health and Wellness. So it's unfortunate that Councillor Digdon just left, because this is about a topic that is very dear to him that he speaks on often, and it is about the EHS response times. So it's a letter of response that we had written, and in the letter it says that once, basically we were looking for response times for 2020, and once that information, the data is generated, they are going to provide that for us. So just so that we know. In B, we received a letter from our Lieutenant Governor, the Honorable Arthur J. LeBlanc, and basically telling us that we are receiving a community spirit plaque because of our, just as Councillor Dontremont said, that demonstrates, because we demonstrated so much spirit and resilience during COVID. So that will be presented. We have the minutes and the newsletter from the library, Western County Regional Library. 6D, there is a letter from our minister, our MLA, sorry, Colton LeBlanc. And this one was about, I'm not sure if you remember, but a few months back I brought up, I had a resident concerned about the safety at the mailboxes because of the lighting, the lack of lighting. And basically what we were told was that Canada Post determines where they put the lighting, and it's kind of up to them, and that's kind of where it sat. But MLA Colton LeBlanc still had more concerns, so he has drafted a letter to send to ask basically what do they consider a safety concern, and where does the lighting go, and how do they determine that? So he's investigating a little further into that. Number seven, we had no financial requests that I can see. Nope. So number eight, are there any agenda topics or notice of motion for councillors for the next meeting? Councillor Donaldson.
Yeah, I probably would like to bring a motion to the next meeting to pre-approve the community grant portion of our budget, because I'm getting a few requests. And I know we do it once in a while for recreation. I'm just wondering if we've ever done it for our community grants, or do we wait till the full budget's passed?
Do we usually wait till the full budget is passed, or
we do, but there's nothing stopping council from making that unilateral decision if it wishes.
Okay.
Before I bring it to, as a motion, I'd like to get a sense: do the councillors want to do something like that, or would you? Just wait for the regular budget.
What do councillors feel? Who would like to comment? Councillor Board?
Me, it doesn't matter, but I'd prefer to wait till the budget comes, because I've told everybody that if they were waiting before we could get letters from them for the grants, for our community grants, that it would be after the budget's gone through. So, I mean, it doesn't really matter. It's whatever everybody else thinks.
Okay, anyone else? Councillor Surratt?
I'd like Councillor Bourque, no offense, Sir Richard, I'd rather wait till the budget. That's my thing. Anyhow, just my comment. Thank you.
Okay, I'll withdraw that. Withdraw that. It's just some of it's school funding. By the time the budget's all done, basically, school's going to be out, so I just had something from Drummond. That's all I wanted to hurry up through. That's all, okay. But it's no big deal. They'll have to wait.
Okay, CEO Muse, did you have something to say?
Well, I do. I believe that those applications may have gone to Recreation, Councillor Donaldson. I have information that I can share with you that might be helpful there. So. yeah, I just, I'm aware of those particular requests, and I believe they may have gone through another channel that I wasn't, that I hadn't advised that was potentially possible. So just so that you're aware. So we'll update you on that.
Okay. Does anybody else have a notice? Anything else? Okay. Anything in question period, CAO means? No? Okay. We are then going to go in camera. So we need a motion to go into camera.
Motion to go in camera.
Okay. I think, Jared, did you want to say something? No. Okay. Motion to go into camera by Councillor Bork. Do we have a seconder?